through the mystic eye, eminent personalities from various walks of life in conversation with Sadhguru. This week features Prasoon Joshi. In conversation with Sadhguru in the ancient city of Banaras or Kashi. In this city where thousands come at the time of their death looking for moksha. Sadhguru reveals the true essence of life and death. Prasoon, a noted lyricist and scriptwriter, represents a new era of creativity in India. Well renowned in the world of poetry and lyrics, he has received over 400 awards and honors for his artistic work, including film fairs, screen, and the coveted National Film Award. His culturally rich and insightful work in the field of advertising and communication has put India and Asia on the international stage. He has also been designated a young global leader by the World Economic Forum and has chaired prestigious international juries in festivals like the Cannes Film Festival. Watch as Prasoon seeks to explore the very mechanics of death and as Sadhguru demystifies this process.
A question I always ask about yoga, and I feel these asanas, and it's my point of view, I mean maybe absolutely wrong, but I feel there's too much of greed in that to learn from other animals. You know, why snake is doing like this? Whoever told you this? I think like that. I'm telling you, that's why I'm asking.
No, whoever told you that really we learned it from the snake?
I mean, you say this asana, that asana. I feel that, why are you doing like a dog? And why are you doing like a lion, you know? Everything you want to learn from, anybody has anything, I want to get the best of it.
No.
Is it greed or is it…
No, the yoga that you have heard about and come in touch with is a rebound from American coast. Okay. people are writing books saying yoga started in California and Madonna was the first practitioner. Okay. Yoga started over 15,000 years ago when Adiyogi taught yoga to his first 7 disciples who are today celebrated as Saptarishis. The yoga that he taught is not a physical exercise, nor is it about animals. People name it according to what there is. See, now you get into this pose, what is this? Give it a name, what? It looks like a boat, we call it a boat pose. Navkasana. This is nothing to do with animals. You sit like this, for me you look like something. And I'll say that, because otherwise how to give a name?
It's just a convenience of names.
Yes, it's got nothing to do with animals.
Yeah. No, I thought, some of the…
Yoga.
I'm very, very little sort of knowledgeable about yoga, so that's the reason it's a very naive question.
The physical asanas are like this. See, if in 70s or early 80s, if you had a television at home, now you're watching your favorite program, suddenly it goes boop, boop, boop in the middle. Then you were a little boy and you run up the terrace and there's a piece of aluminium, you adjust it like this. If you get it to the right place, again the whole world pours in. So yoga means just this, getting your body aligned with the cosmic geometry. If you just learn to hold this right, you can download the whole cosmos. It is from that basis that Kashi has been created, to create a large human body, a magnificent human body which doesn't have the inertia of carrying physicality with it, so that it will be on all the time and it can just download the whole process. That is what the phenomenal effort that they made in Kashi.
Great.
An individual can do it, but to make it happen for many people is a different game.
So you mean if you see a satellite view of Kashi, it would resemble a kind of a yantra or something like that?
Definitely. Even in if you come up in a hot air balloon or a helicopter, you can see the yantra form. That is the physical aspect. But some people are claiming they have taken pictures of the energy form, which I have not seen. Just in the last 2 days people have been telling me, some journalists.
That's exactly how I was introducing you, that you do not mystify it beyond a point, and that's what I like about you especially. Because I feel in the world of religion and the world of spirituality, you can, because there's so many layers…
No, the work of a guru is to make the mystical available
exactly
to the existing human being. What is available, they're making it mystical.
Yes.
What is already grasped, that they're trying to make it mystical. No, what is not being grasped, which seems mysterious to other people, you bring it down in a way that people can grasp it. That is your work. Not to take away what they have, that is political job.
Amazing.
They want us to go to them.
Yeah, fantastic. That on one hand we say that, you know, this is just change of clothes. But why do people glorify when they come to Kashi the death so much? Why do we need so much of ritual around? So one is this question which comes to mind. Second thing is, what is this moksha? What is this mukti? That why isn't it against life, rebirth, everything? Isn't it that we are glorifying death far too much, and ultimate death in Kashi, which is mukti, it means we are against life. We think that being reborn is a curse. These are the questions which I wanted to ask you.
Did you enjoy your school?
Yes,
your I schooling. Did. You yes. enjoyed it?
Yes.
But were you very eager to go to college? So when you passed out of your 10th,
yes, I think so.
10th or 12th standard,
yeah.
Suppose we admitted you again to kindergarten, yeah, because you enjoyed it so much, would you like it? Or would you like to go to college?
I simply did not think that time. It's just that it's natural thing that you go into next.
You go to the next stage, isn't it? So if you've seen enough of this life, you want to go to the next stage, you don't want to do the same thing again. What's wrong with that?
Yeah, but what one says when one says about moksha, what I have heard, maybe it's a half-baked knowledge. But the fact is that you will not be reborn again.
Yes.
You will. It's a, so being. Why is such an effort?
You don't want to go back to kindergarten again. What's wrong with that?
No, but you're saying that you want to don't want to go there, go anywhere after that.
No. That's not.
You don't want to be born in any form.
Yes.
Yeah.
You don't want to go back to school. Once again.
So every form is a school, you're saying?
It's one stage of life.
But then why do we say that, you know, being born as an ant and being born as a human being are two different things?
Because of the possibility, not because we think we are superior. Nobody in this part of the world has ever told you that you are made in God's own image or anything like this. That is the reason why we have all kinds of gods and goddesses. In Kashi, they manufactured 33 million gods and goddesses. In the form of an elephant, in the form of a snake, in the form of a cow, in the form of a dog, every kind. Just to make you understand, every life has its place. And there is no life happening here without the hand of Creator being actively involved in it. If you watch an ant closely enough, it's a magnificent piece of engineering and mechanics and creation. So, it cannot be happening without the hand of the Creator in it. That is the reason why in this culture, we told you, if you look at a tree, you bow down, you look at a rock, you bow down, you look at a cow, you bow down, you look at God, you do the same thing, you look at a man, woman or child, you do the same thing. Because you recognize the hand of the divine is in everything that is there. Every atom cannot function without the source of creation throbbing in it. For yourself, did you create this body from outside, did you borrow it from outside, or did it happen from within? You gave it food from outside. But making a banana into a human being happened from within, isn't it?
Yeah.
So there is an intelligence and a competence which is the very source of creation within this. So now, to acknowledge that, first thing. So that is the reason all kinds of gods, everything is divine in this country. Here the saying is, Shiva himself said, Kashika Kankar Shiv Shankar. Every stone in Kashi is Shiva.
Yeah.
So you don't bow down to one thing and not bow down to another thing. Everything you bow down, because everything has an element of the source of creation. The possibility of human being is that you can realize that.
Yeah, but the fact that Kashi is so significant, what is the significance of this city?
These rituals are not glorification of death. This is not a celebration. This is a scientific process. Being in Mumbai city, you might not know this. If you ask the people in the villages or if you run an undertaker's business, you would know this. A dead body up to 11 to 12 days continues to grow its nails and hair and things like that. It's a fact of life.
I've heard this, yes.
So because when you when you happened in your mother's womb, you didn't happen like a flash. It happened slowly for a period of time. Similarly, when the prana leaves the body, it happens slowly. Someone may be practically dead. For all practical purposes, he may be dead. But still, the prana has not left his system. Still it is there. There are many ways to use this also. And above all, as long as the prana is there in the body, the person who's left the body is confused. See, from outside observers, we think he's dead. As far as he is concerned, he slipped out of the body. When I say slipping out of the body, let's set up a proper perspective for this. When you were born, your body was only this much. Now it became this much. How? You gathered it from outside, isn't it? This is just a piece of the planet. From the food that you ate, you gathered it. What you gather can be yours. You can claim it to be yours for now. But it cannot be you, isn't it? Can it be you?
Then what am I?
Don't jump now. Whatever you gather, it can be yours at the most, it cannot be you, isn't it?
Yeah.
I gather this clothing and after some time if I say this is me, this is insanity, isn't it? That's what has happened to people. They gather this body and they think they are this. So this insanity has set in. Because the majority is with you and we are following democratic systems, whatever the majority says is right. But that's stupid. You know you gathered it. What you gather cannot be you. It's nothing short of insanity. Because everybody is in the same condition, we think it's okay. But what is not okay is not okay. So the basis of all human suffering and confusion and lack of understanding of life has come from this one point, that you don't understand that you are mortal every moment of your life. So the purpose of making a public display of cremations here is for you to know that you are mortal. And you realize you're mortal. When your time is up, you come to Kashi preparing yourself to die. So this mortality is the only thing which fires you to think of what's beyond. If you were immortal, you wouldn't think of anything. Your life would have no meaning, isn't it? Only because it's going to end. And what is going to end is just what you gathered. This body is a loan that you've taken from this planet. You take the loan from the planet. When the time to repay comes, because most people have made nothing of it except thinking rubbish in their head, psychological realities, however big they may be, they will collapse in a moment. When the moment of death comes, what you thought, what you felt, your thought and emotion will mean nothing. Existentially, what have you done with this being? That's all that matters. That dimension is largely obliterated in the society today because of very strong Western influence.
What is exactly death? Is the decaying of body or the dying of body is death? On one hand, my body is dying, and my thoughts, my ideas are becoming something which the world suppose embraces, and they live without me. So is it, would you call it death? What would you define death as?
Have you ever died? It's all right for poetry you wrote. Have you really ever died? Did you die and come back? No. In your experience, no, isn't it? Did you ever see somebody who died and came back?
I haven't seen anyone.
Have you ever seen a dead man?
I don't think so.
So you have not seen one, you have not met one, nor have you experienced. So where did you get this idea that you will die?
It is learned thought.
That's what. It is a fiction of the ignorant, created by the ignorant. There is no such thing as death. There's just life, life and life, moving from one dimension to another. So only when people are ignorant and their vision of life and their perception of life is very limited to physical nature of the existence, then they will think of life and death. Otherwise, there's just life and life.
Wonderful, wonderful. So you are saying death does not exist?
Don't believe me, what I say. I am only asking you, let us remove…
No, I understand what
you're saying. Let us remove what's not true. Let us not talk about truth.
No, but if you forget philosophy and you see what you see, is that there was a person whom you could touch and feel?
No, there was a body that you could touch and feel. Many times desperately you tried to touch the being, but you never did. At the most, you touch their body, you touch their thoughts, you touch their emotions, you try to touch them, but you never did.
But you feel their absence when they are not there.
Because a body is missing, a mind is missing, the chatter is missing, emotions are missing. That's what you're missing, you're not missing the being at all.
But that missing is missing because I'm feeling it.
Missing is just a psychological process, isn't it?
Isn't it a physical process as well?
Yes, physical and psychological.
Your mother who used to feed you, who used to, you know, hug you, is no more doing that.
See, physically very easily we can replace things. It is the psychological and emotional factor which is irreplaceable because of the uniqueness of the psychological structure of that person and the uniqueness of the emotional relationship between those two people. It is that which is irreplaceable. Physicality can be replaced effortlessly, isn't it?
Sadhguru, I wanted to ask you about why do human have the fear of death so much? What is that makes us so uncomfortable and not at ease with death?
See, it's not death which is disturbing for people. Here in… right now we are in front of Manikarnik. Right next to that is the Kala Bhairav temple. What you see there is Kala Bhairav temple. Bhairav is one who takes you beyond fear. Kal Bhairav is the fear of time. It is the fear of time, it's not the fear of death. In fact, in southern Indian languages, that is the terminology used for death, kalamaitanga, kalamaipoinar, kalavadaru, all southern Indian languages. See, his time is up.
Hmm.
So, the fear is always about the time. Time is the basis of fear. If you had limitless amount of time, it wouldn't matter, isn't it? It is time is running out. If something happens, time is the issue. If something doesn't happen, time is the issue.
Yeah.
So, death essentially means your time is up. So, it is a limited amount of time which you are referring to as life. And you know, if you do not do certain things within that span, you will not… you will be unfulfilled in so many ways. So, people who live a very full-fledged life, you will see when the time to leave comes, they will live much more gracefully than people who have not lived a total life. If their experience is big, they lived very joyfully with a huge sense of ecstasy about life, such people will die with ease. Actually, those are the people who should not be eager to go, isn't it? People who have a bad life should be wanting to go, but that's not the truth.
So the discomfort and the fear is nothing but the fact that the time is
yes,
not there.
That is why Kal Bhairav, if you are free from the fear of time, you are free from fear itself, absolutely. Kal is also seen as black because you don't see what is next. It's completely dark. Time hides what is tomorrow, isn't it?